Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
Number of official sources in the headquarters of the International Atomic Energy Agency, IAEA, in Vienna have confirmed that Iran indeed resumed its uranium enrichment program in the Natanz facility. Iran would be able to produce a nuclear fuel for military or civil purposes. This news comes amidst an announcement by the head of the Defense Committee in the Iranian parliament, Ridha Talayi, that his country would be able to achieve a complete nuclear fuel energy cycle within 6 months. In another development, some Iranian reformists have urged Tehran to deal with the nuclear file issue with a great deal of restraint and wisdom. They also cautioned Iran not to adopt a hardline policy while negotiating with the West.
In a fiery speech before a large crowd commemorating the foundation of the Islamic Republic of Iran, President Ahmadinejad had vowed that Tehran will resume its nuclear program. Iranians have split between supporters and opponents to Ahmadinejad's decision of resuming the program.
Our people have dealt with you with a great degree of dignity and pride. We have reconsidered our policy regarding the treaty of limiting the spread of weapons of mass destruction. Therefore, you must deal with us in a rational and respectful manner.
Ahmadinejad's position was reiterated by the head of the Defense Committee in the Iranian parliament, Ridha Talayi. He has confirmed that Tehran will possess a complete nuclear fuel energy cycle within a few months.
We have benefited from mistakes made by the IAEA against us. We will achieve a complete nuclear fuel energy cycle within a few months, away from international pressure and scrutiny. Our people are able to face any aggression despite its
وتجاه هذه التصريحات المتشددة في معالجة الأزمة النووية بين إيران والغرب، سجل المراقبون
Some reformers did not like these harsh statements towards the West as a way to resolve the nuclear dilemma between Iran and the West. This was evident in the statement made by the Expediency Council Chairman Akbar Hashemi Rafsanjani, who participated in a huge demonstration saying that there is a greater need to use wisdom and caution to deal with malicious Western political maneuverings. Rafsanjani added that Iran needs to decide on the right strategy to deal with the matter more than it needs power. Former Speaker of the Parliament, Mahdi Karobi, pointed out the importance of using awareness, patience, and diplomatic skills to persuade other countries of Iran's right to develop peaceful nuclear energy. Karobi demanded the resumption of diplomatic talks and giving up quarrels. These internal differences in Iran will most likely deepen, especially after the Iranian President Ahmadinejad gave his fiery speech. Hashemi Rafsanjani has significant monitoring authority over Ahmadinejad's performance. This may lead to a way out of this crisis by utilizing what seems to be the last opportunity before the time runs out.
More than 1 million Lebanese of all faiths waving flags and carrying anti-Syrian banners massed in March Square, highlighting their determination to continue on the path of slain Premier Hariri and build in their will to live in a stable and united country. Yumna Tayara reports.
Once again they gathered, similar to the historical March 14th demonstration. More than 500,000 faithful Lebanese carried signs calling for the truth and shouting, quote, they feared you, so they killed you. He left Lebanon and died for its sake. Others carried signs critical of Syria and Lebanese President Emil Lahoud. Kick out Bashar's agent from Abda, they read. Demonstrators poured into downtown Beirut from the early hours of the morning to mark the first anniversary of the assassination of former Premier Rafiq al-Hariri, MP Basif Layhan and their companions. People of all ages and from every corner of the country united under the Lebanese flag and adorned in one color, blue, the symbol of the truth. White and yellow roses circulated among the crowd, symbolizing freedom and liberty, the causes Thane Hariri died fighting for. All gathered to pay tribute to Hariri, describing him as a great man who offered a lot for his country.
Lebanon is united in this day, and this is great, very great, very good.
Hariri is the perfect man in the earth. We don't have the words to explain what he did and what he will did to the people.
Rafiq al-Hariri means to me all of the world, because he is really kind man, gentleman, and I don't know what I... I'm sorry, because I'm very sad.
The demonstration climaxed shortly after midday, at the time when a huge truck bomb exploded a year ago in Ain Lembreisi, killing Hariri. Thousands of troops and policemen backed by armored vehicles sealed off Beirut's downtown area to provide security and guarded approaches to the city. The rally was mainly called for by the head of the Future Bloc in Parliament, MP Saad Hariri. In an interview with the local TV channel LBC yesterday, Hariri described last year's 14th of February as a day of national awakening. Hariri held the Syrian Lebanese security apparatus responsible of the vandalism acts that occurred in Ashrafieh last Sunday, stressing that all Lebanese wanted was for the Syrian system to stop its interference. He noted that the agreement pact between Hezbollah and the Free Patriotic Movement did not mention the Taif Accord. MP Hariri further added that his alliance with MP Walid Jumblat was strategic and that he would not bargain on it since it was founded by his Thane father, Rafiq al-Hariri. He reiterated his call for President Enil Lahoud to resign, revealing that a mechanism was in the process for shortening its extended mandate. The main pro-Syrian movements, Hezbollah and Amal, were not taking part in the commemoration. But according to media sources, Amal is holding its own commemoration later today in southern Lebanon.
365 days have passed. Lebanese gathered under one flag to commemorate the February 14 assassination with one demand, the complete and full truth.
A year has passed since the assassination of former Lebanese Prime Minister Rafiq al-Hariri, and Lebanon has witnessed many developments, most notably the attack on positions taken by Prime Minister Hariri before his assassination. Most importantly, Lebanon's Arab identity and the unique relationship that links the two brotherly countries of Syria and Lebanon.
مشهد لم يعتد عليه اللبنانيون وبالأخص أهالي بيروت إلا عندما غزت القوات الإسرائيلية لبنان.
The Lebanese people, especially the residents of Beirut, have not witnessed such a scene since the Israeli invasion of Lebanon, when it bombed and invaded Beirut. This scene was repeated on February 14th, when former Lebanese Prime Minister Rafiq al-Hariri was assassinated. Some people described this assassination as an earthquake. In the first seconds afterwards, Syria described it as a terrorist act targeting Lebanon, its national unity, and civil peace. A year has passed since the assassination of Hariri. The year has been filled with grave incidents, conspiracies, and direct accusations against Damascus for being behind the assassination. These accusations came seconds after the assassination, even before the late Prime Minister's body was transferred from the scene, and before the Lebanese government even announced the identities of the victims of the explosion. The plot of the assassination of Rafiq al-Hariri was planned in a way to produce clear changes to the political situation in the region, specifically in Syria and Lebanon. This raises many questions. Most importantly, who benefits from the assassination of Hariri, the closest ally to Syria? Some Lebanese political forces have pretended to follow the footsteps of Hariri while taking advantage of his assassination to gain parliamentary seats or obtain ministerial positions. In reality, reality, they care less about reaching the truth and answering questions that Lebanese citizens have been asking since the first second after the assassination. Why does Israel distance itself while its history has set new records of assassinations since its occupation of Palestine until today? Regardless of what some people say about Prime Minister Hariri trying to take advantage of his assassination, he was part of a national Arab project that was launched from Lebanon in coordination with Damascus. Hariri supported the establishment of this unique relationship between Syria and Lebanon to guarantee the success of this project, which came in the framework of the Taif Agreement. The late Hariri confirmed this when he literally said, "It is impossible for Rafiq al-Hariri to be with anyone except Syria and the national Arab plight, which he devoted his life to, and that he is with the Lebanese national resistance." With these firm positions, Prime Minister Hariri also stood with the rights of the Palestinians and opposed the American occupation of Iraq. However, some backwards and shameful forces are working with Israel and other major international powers to shake these positions by opposing the Arab identity of Lebanon, taking aim at the Syrian-Lebanese relations while the two countries continue to coordinate on Arab and international issues. Who are the parties that have an interest in this assassination? Why did the International Court accuse Syria, which has been the most affected by this incident? Syria was more of a target by the assassination, more than the assassination itself. It is no doubt that those who assassinated Hariri knew what would happen by the murder of such an important man, and that it would serve the interests of the conspirators who hatched plans for the region, starting with targeting Syria and Lebanon. May God have mercy on Prime Minister Hariri's soul, and may God protect Lebanon from the evil of those who continue their dangerous and delusional gambles. They take advantage of the assassination, even on the day of the anniversary, in order to carry out their hellish plots, which is no less dangerous than the sinful and terrible crime of the assassination.
استشهدت المواطنة فاطمة أبو مساعد البالغة من العمر 25.
فاطمة أبو مسلم, a 25-year-old Palestinian woman, was murdered in the eastern part of the town of Qara, north of the municipality of Khan Yunis. She was killed by Israeli soldiers positioned in areas along the eastern border of the Gaza Strip. Members of the Peres Peace Center, a number of Israeli activists, and local residents in the town of Salim, east of Nablus, have planted olive trees on land that is in danger of being confiscated by the Israeli occupation forces.
مصادرة من قبل قوات الاحتلال.
Local residents in the town of Salim and others who own land near the mountains have suffered tremendously at the hands of Israeli settlers. Jewish settlers have targeted Palestinian farmlands, burning and destroying vegetation and olive trees. Most residents in this town depend on olive trees as a primary source of living.
This is our land, and it is our way of life. This is the blood of the martyrs. They were martyred on this land and for the sake of it. This is our land and soil. Many martyrs were killed on this land.
I went to check on my fields and olive trees. I saw an Israeli bulldozer on my land. It dropped off a load of rocks, causing injury to my arm.
He has 14 children.
The settlers also hurled a pile of rocks on me, injuring my head. Four of them blocked my way and prevented me from going to my farm.
The Jews took our country, farmland, and our olive trees, and they kicked us out. They defeated us because they are powerful and they have weapons. If we had arms, we would have fought them, but we don't have any. We cannot defeat them with a stick, can we? No.
Look at all of these olive trees destroyed by Israeli settlers. We plant and they destroy. Since they came here, we cannot plow our land, care for it, or benefit from it. Who are they? They are Jadun.
Who is Jadun?
The settlers.
What do they do?
They chase us around. They use guns and dogs to keep us away from our land. The settlers claim that they are the ones who own this land and they will build houses on it.
Thousands of acres of land in the town of Salim are subject to confiscation by Israeli settlers. Jewish settlers prevent local residents from tending to their land and reaping the fruits of their trees and plants during harvest season. Only these farmers who have prior arrangements with the Israelis can farm their land.
There are two Israeli settlements around here. One is the Elie Moreh and the other one is in the east part of the town of Salem. Settlers targeted our land in many occasions. They destroyed our crops, burnt our plants, and uprooted our olive trees. We filed complaints at the Israeli military headquarters. The police came out many times and investigated the incidents. Each time they would blame the attacks on anonymous party or parties. And everyone knows that the settlers from the eastern settlement were the perpetrators. The latest incident took place in November 2005. The settlers have uprooted, broke down, damaged, and burnt a significant amount of plants and olive trees. They have burnt down nearly 300 acres of olive trees.
The problem of the town of Salim is still going on, waiting for a comprehensive solution. And there are hundreds of untold tales about the pain and suffering of these local residents living on this stretched farmland, hoping that one day they will get their freedom and their land back, a land that they can freely farm and plant on it their vegetables without fear. The German Foreign Minister Frank-Walter Steinmeier has called on Hamas to comply with the European Union conditions. He also confirmed that his country will continue to support the Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas and his policy in leading the Palestinian Authority. He demanded that the Islamic Resistance Movement recognize Israel and renounce terrorism.
The German foreign minister arrived today in the Palestinian territories from Tel Aviv. He asked Hamas, which came to power through democratic means, to comply with the European Union conditions. Mr. Steinmeier met with President Abbas and with his Palestinian counterpart, ignoring the newly elected leadership of Hamas. He has confirmed that his government and the European Union will continue to support the current Palestinian government. As far as his country's relation with Hamas is concerned, the German foreign minister did not elaborate on the subject. However, he stressed that Hamas must comply with the European Union conditions.
The German conditions are similar to those of the European Union. We will continue our support to the Palestinian government during its transition period. After the new government swears in, we do not know what course of action we will take.
The Palestinian Authority tried to convince international donors to continue financial aid to the Palestinian people in lieu of the new government of Hamas. The Palestinian foreign minister is betting that the position of the new government will differ from the positions of the political blocs that make up such government. Hamas, which confirmed that it will not comply with the European conditions, has expressed disappointment in the European Union's stance. It contended that the Union has two contradictory positions. One is public and the other is behind the scenes.
The European Union has adopted an announced political position, which is not to negotiate with Hamas. Meanwhile, many European countries tried to open dialogue with the Islamic Resistance Movement. Hamas did hold a number of talks with the Europeans. It is a European double standard policy. In one side, the European Union has tried to deal with Hamas in an arrogant manner and under a set of conditions. On the other side, they opened dialogue with Hamas, realizing that the will and choice of the Palestinian people that brought it to power.
Hamas faces mounting domestic and foreign pressure. It is between a rock and a hard place. While the West expects Hamas will eventually bow to financial pressures, the Islamic Resistance Movement confirmed that it has legitimacy, which could change world opinion and ultimately lift the European conditions.
أثار قرار المحكمة الإدارية التركية
The decision by the Turkish Administrative Court to ban Turkish teachers from wearing the headscarf or hijab outside public schools drew violent reactions by the government. The opposition parties condemned the decision, which they considered nullified civil liberties. They held the government responsible for changing the laws.
صدق أو لا تصدق المحكمة الإدارية التركية اعتبرت ارتداء معلمات
Believe it or not, the Turkish Administrative Court considers wearing the hijab by public teachers and lecturers, even outside public schools and Ministry of Education buildings, as a violation of the law. They rejected teachers' rights to express their identity by wearing the hijab. The decision drew an angry response from the Turkish Prime Minister, Recep Tayyip Erdogan, who denounced it and considered it an obvious intervention of personal freedoms, noting that if this decision remains, it will soon lead to court intervention into public life and into a citizen's choice of what to wear in their own home. The Turkish Foreign Minister, Abdullah Gül, considered the decision confusing and contradicting freedom. The Minister of State, Kürşat Tuzman, called for integrating the legislative, executive, and judicial laws.
وزير الدولة بضرورة انسجام السلطات التشريعية والتنفيذية والقضائية.
If there was coordination and integration between the executive, legislative and judicial authorities, this mistake would not have happened as a result of competition between the authorities.
The opposition parties, which represent the right and center-right, strongly criticized the decision of the court and the procrastination of the government to come up with legal and constitutional amendments to protect the civil liberties of women who wear hijab.
We denounce the decision of the court. However, the responsibility falls on the Justice and Development Party because they have the majority in the parliament and can end this debate by amending the laws.
We denounce the decision of the court. We must not implement the current laws in public institutions that affect the personal lives of citizens.
The decision of the court conflicts with civil liberties, as if they want citizens to dress only one way. This goes against the values of democracy.
The Turkish opposition parties have thrown the ball into the government's court, which is now compelled to protect human rights and civil and religious liberties throughout the parliament. Erdogan and his minister's reaction against the administrative court decision is not sufficient to truly protect their Islamic base from the reckless measures taken by the secular judges. Though the Justice and Development Party has the majority in the parliament, which enables it to change the constitution and amend laws, it refrains from doing so because it fears the anger of the army and Ataturk secularists.
Iraqi consumers have been discouraged from buying white meat due to fear that the bird flu epidemic has hit home. The general manager of Public Veterinarian Association, Dahoud Muhammad Sharif, has confirmed that there is no outbreak of the bird flu in Iraq.
After the announcement that there has been an outbreak of the bird flu in the Kurdistan province, Iraqis have expressed fear. Consumers have stopped buying white meat, causing prices of red meat and fish to skyrocket.
Most Iraqi households consume meals containing chicken at least twice a week. Because of the epidemic, many of them have turned to consumption of red meat and fish, which has caused spending to go up.
Some people buy red meat on a regular basis. However, white meat and eggs have always been a part of Iraqi meals. More people now buy fish and red meat due to this epidemic. Why do neighboring countries have vaccinations against the bird flu and our country does not?
Merchants have suffered the most due to this epidemic. Supplies of chicken are at their highest level. Poultry importers and traders have asked the concerned authorities to announce that chicken products are safe to eat and do not have the flu.
ارتفع الى 9000 دينار الكيلو في حين اللحوم الدواجن اللحوم البيضاء انخفضت الى
Prices of red meat have risen to 9000 denaries a kilogram. However, poultry prices have gone down significantly. They now sell at very low costs. In fact, they are selling at prices that are below actual cost. This causes major losses to chicken importers and a surplus of inventory in warehouses. We ask the concerned authorities, especially health officials, to announce through media outlets that these flocks of poultry were imported via authorized ports, not smuggled in, and were fully inspected.
وتم فحصها بشكل جيد.
Mr. Dawood Muhammad Sharif, the General Manager of Public Veterinarian Association, has confirmed that poultry consumers are not at risk and they can eat chicken products and eggs.
تؤكد مرة للألف هذه الدواجن خالية من مرض.
For the thousandth time, I confirm that these flocks of chicken do not have the flu. Iraq is free of this bird flu. There's only one remote area near Sarkib Khan that has been diagnosed with the flu. The epidemic has been contained in that area, which is now under quarantine. There have been no new outbreaks besides the two original cases in which two people died. Iraq does not have the bird flu. There have been no reports of any outbreak in any part of Iraq, including I would like to appeal to all Iraqis through your channel not to fear and not to listen to rumors. Iraq does not have the epidemic and all poultry products, including eggs, are 100% safe to consume. Iraqis cook their meat at high temperature, usually at 90 degrees Celsius, which is sufficient to kill the virus that lives in temperatures below 70 degrees Celsius. Therefore, cooking food at the right temperature will kill viruses and bacteria, making it safe for human consumption.
The Iraqi government has taken health and safety precautions to reassure people. Government officials have confirmed that there is no need to panic.
Shoshana Damari passed away today at Ichilov Hospital in Tel Aviv after suffering complications from pneumonia. Damari, who immigrated to Israel as a young child from Yemen, began performing at the age of 16 and went on to win the Israel Prize for her contribution to Israeli song. IBA's Leah Stern takes a look at her life and work.
Shoshana Damari, the queen of Israeli song, passed away this morning. She was surrounded at her deathbed in Ichilov Hospital in Tel Aviv by family and friends, including pop star Idan Reichel, who she met while collaborating on several songs on his latest album. Her loved ones played her classic song, Kalaniot, or Windflower, in her final moments. Her niece said, "She went out just the way she would have wanted. We sang her songs until the very end," she said. Following her death, the Knesset and President's office released a condolence message reading, quote, "Her voice unified the entire nation and spread optimism and hope." M.K. Ran Cohen requested that the singer receive a state funeral, saying that cultural heroes, not just politicians, deserve state honor. Acting Prime Minister Ehud Olmert expressed his condolences, saying, "She was one of the giants of our culture. Her voice accompanied Israel for over 60 years, from the struggles of the underground to the declaration of the state, through war and peace, sorrow and joy." Damari will be remembered as a lover of her fellow person, the land of Israel, and the Hebrew language. The Israeli actress and singer immigrated with her family from Damar, Yemen, to Israel in 1924, when she was just 2 years old. As a child, she performed at weddings with her mother while studying acting and singing in Tel Aviv. By the time she was just 14 years old, she began singing on Israeli radio and appearing in theaters throughout the country. At the age of 25, Damari recorded her first album and embarked on a world tour. She was one of the first Israeli performers to enjoy a world acclaim. Lovers of music the world over could not resist her strong alto voice with its Yemenite intonations. She would also perform at the army bases during peacetime and war, singing her heart out to soldiers on duty. Damari was awarded the Israeli Prize in 1988 for her contribution to Israeli song. In one of her final interviews, Damari said, "I'm happy that I'll leave behind so much, that I gave so much pleasure to an entire country. I have no fear of the end. Whenever it happens, it will happen." Shoshana Damari, dead at 83.
The views expressed on Mosaic are not those of Link TV or its sponsors, but of the broadcasters themselves. Mosaic is made possible by a grant from the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, which promotes journalism excellence worldwide and invests in the vitality of 26 U.S. communities, and the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. Additional support is provided by the Fyredahl Foundation and Henry and Virgilia Dakin.